All right.
And excuse me, I've had a really bad cold in the last few days. I've been sneezing and hacking, and so I'll try to get through this, but forgive me if I get into one of my sneezing fits. I felt like I was going to sneeze my brains out today. And then somebody told me I didn't have any, not to worry about it.
That's love.
All right, so this class is going to be called First Vision, and I think you might find it interesting. It's not every day that somebody tells you they met God face to face, and that's what Joseph Smith claimed, and so that's what we're going to be talking about today. So let's find out first, who is Joseph Smith? See about some of his history, see what I can tell you about him. I'm going to stand up so I don't fall asleep. Joseph Smith was born in Windsor County, Vermont, to Joseph Smith Sr. and Lucy Mack Smith on December 23rd, 1805. So you'll often hear him referred to as Joseph Smith Jr. to distinguish him from his father. The Smith family moved to Palmyra, New York in 1816. They had, he claimed to have the first vision, which is what we're going to talk about tonight. It was in the spring of 1820 when he saw God the Father and Jesus Christ, two different people. Visited by the angel Moroni on September 1823. We'll get more into that next week. He married his first wife, Emma Hale, on January of 1827. He obtained the gold plates from which he supposedly translated the Book of Mormon.
Were they in hieroglyphics? Do they know?
He said that they were called, that he referred to them as Reformed Egyptian, and to this day we haven't found anything called Reformed. Something like that. I'll actually, next week I'll have a picture of what he drew some of them. But they've never found anything like it ever.
They haven't found the place to get either.
No. No. He began translation of those plates in December 1827. He received the Aaronic priesthood, and we're going to have a whole class on the priesthood. Two different priesthoods here. The Aaronic priesthood, which you may have heard referred to as the Levitical priesthood. This is the priesthood that the Levites held. And he received that directly from John the Baptist, who came and laid hands upon him there in New York in 1829. Then he received the Melchizedek priesthood, which is the priesthood that Jesus Christ himself holds. And he received that directly under Peter, James, and John, who came back and ordained him in the year June 1829. The Book of Mormon was published in March of 1830. He organized the church, which when I mean that, he actually went to the courthouse and got, you know, all the legal documentation you have to actually form a church and a religion, however you want to word that. And they had their first church meeting on April 6, 1830, and Mormons believe that that's the actual birthday of Jesus. And we know that Jesus was not born on December 25th. We all know that, right?
Yeah.
He was born in spring, and they claim they know the date. April 6th. 0000, I guess, huh? Moved the headquarters of the church to Kirtland, Ohio in 1830. Organized the first presidency in March of 1833. That means he called, you know, a first counselor, a second counselor, talked about that, his right-hand man, his left-hand man. Organized the Quorum of the 12 Apostles in February of 1835, so now he's got 12 apostles under him, so he's like Jesus and his 12 apostles. So it was Joseph and his 12 apostles. Dedicated the Kirtland Temple on March 27th, 1836, where he was visited by all past prophets. What's going on, my thing here? Am I on there?
No.
Sorry. so in this Kirtland Temple, and we're going to talk about that when we do the Temple Night, he was visited by all past prophets and apostles who gave him counsel and priesthood keys to the restoration. Also was visited by Jesus Christ again. So you understand, he didn't just see, we're going to talk about the first vision. That's why they call it the first vision, because he had many. He claimed that he met every single prophet and apostle mentioned in the Bible and the Book of Mormon. So Elijah, Moses, Abraham, they all came to visit him. He's the greatest prophet ever, and they came to turn over their authorities to him in the Kirtland Temple. He arrived at Far West, Missouri in March of 1838. He was imprisoned in Liberty Jail, Missouri, from 1838 to April 1839. And that, you know, a lot of people feel sorry for Joseph on some of these things like when he was in prison in Liberty Jail. He was 6 foot tall, and they put him in the basement of this jail, him and some of his buddies, and from the floor to the ceiling, I think, was only 5.5 feet. So for 6 months, he could not stand up straight. So you hear a lot of this stuff about persecution, and people in the church feel so sorry for Joseph, but why were they putting him in jail? Why? What was he doing that was getting him into all this trouble, right? Everybody in prison's innocent, right? Gathered the church to Nauvoo, Illinois in the spring of 1839. Laid the cornerstone for the Nauvoo Temple, 1841. Organized the Ladies Relief Society in March 1842. So that's that's a crazy story. The Ladies Relief Society is sort of the female version of the priesthood, I guess. They don't hold priesthood power, but it's the ladies' organization. They would get together and they'd do things like feed the hungry and stuff like that. But I think at the first meeting, I don't remember now, there's like half the women there or something like that. He had some kind of affair with them at the time. He became a Freemason on March 15th, 1842, which is significant. Talk about in later class. He was shot and killed with his brother Hiram at Carthage Jail, Carthage, Illinois, June 27, 1844. It was not a martyrdom. Many Mormons will tell you that he was a martyr. You know what a martyrdom is? That means you willingly give your life for go ahead.
How much has his original Book of Mormon changed?
We're going to talk about that next week. Quite a few things, and they're doctrinal. They'll tell you that they are grammatical changes, a period for a question mark, whatever. No, they were doctrinal changes, and we're going to talk about those next week. And I have a copy of the original print of the Book of Mormon, and today's what they print today, and they're different.
Is the temple that's in Kirtland, did they leave that intact when they left?
Still there. I've been there. It's now owned by the Community in Christ, which used to be called the Reformed Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
I've been to the one that the Reformed Church in Walnut Creek that's there.
Yeah,
because it still, polygamy is still practiced from that church, I believe, is it not?
No. Now the Reformers, that was Emma Smith's church. And her son Joseph III, and once Joseph died, she didn't want any more part of polygamy, and so I don't think they ever practiced that at all.
Understood that then.
Is there anything in the history about Joseph Smith being a charismatic leader? I'm wondering why he got so many people following.
Oh yeah, he was very charismatic. There are a lot of stories about how ladies would spend a few minutes with him, and he was very charming.
Is that how he lived? The women supported him?
Is that how the women...
Did he have a job when he was organizing this church?
Before all of this, when he was younger, before he claimed to have all these visions and stuff, he was a treasure seeker. And we're going to talk about that a little more next week. He had a stone. It was a treasure stone. And he claimed that he could find treasure with this stone. It's kind of like you seen these guys with the stick and the tune, the vining rod, and they would find water and stuff, all that kind of stuff that was going on in the 1800s, and he was right in the middle of all of that. I believe he did. And then, but then when he was in Nauvoo, he had a general store. They call it the Red Brick Store, and he sold general merchandise. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right here.
The Bible that we have that is parallel to what Joseph Smith wrote, the King James Version. Uh-huh. Is that something that a normal Mormon would have, or is that something you obtained after you left the church?
No, I had it while I was still in church, but it's not something a Mormon typically carries around. You can go to Deseret Book, which is it's a bookstore owned by the church. There's actually one in Sacramento. There's a brick and mortar store there. Or you can go online and you can get they print a copy of just the inspired version. They call it the inspired version. You can get that. But typically Mormons don't carry that.
Would that be helpful if you're trying to show a Mormon the difference between? Would it be helpful to them to influence them in any way if they had that?
I don't think so, because it would be hard for you to find where those changes are because they're not distinguished. Does that make sense? You'd have to know where the book that I had, it distinguishes just the changes, and you can get that too.
Do they celebrate Christmas and when?
Yes, December 25th.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. George?
The Mormons used what was similar to a red letter Bible, Joseph Smith's version, and that was, for me, I remember seeing that back about 30, 35 years ago, actually even further, 40 years ago. So it would be the regular Bible.
Thank you.
And then anything that Joseph added was then highlighted in red.
I haven't seen
kind
that
like
one.
Jesus' words.
Yeah.
So we have Joseph's words.
Okay, I haven't seen that one. I'd like to see that.
Would you continue your thought on martyrdom and what's a martyr and what is not a martyr?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
Yeah,
I got
just wanted to bring it. Yeah.
So, he was not martyred. Martyrdom is when you gladly lay down your life for whatever it is, your teaching or your religion or whatever. In the Bible, Stephen was stoned, and he just looked up to heaven and said, "Forgive them what they're about to do, and Lord, take me home." And he just laid down and died. Joseph did not do that. Story's not told that often, but he had a revolver and he shot back. He was not aiming to die that day. Okay, you'll hear. He did say that when he was headed off to Carthage jail to turn himself in, he said he was going away as a lamb to slaughter. At least that's the way the story goes. And so that sort of says that he thought he might die, but he was packing a gun with him. Actually, wasn't packing it with him. Somebody brought it to the jail later. But he shot back. He fought. He tried to run. He tried to get out the window. He did not lay down his life and die, so he was not a martyr. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Sure. All right.
The men he killed didn't die instantly. They actually suffered for a long time through infection from the wounds. Two men died, and the third man was brought to court and was released as an innocent man.
Yeah, they were all like, no one ever was charged. And the church for a long time said that the United States must pay for the death of Joseph Smith. All right, so let's get to the first vision. And I'm going to read what they call the canonized version of Joseph Smith's story here. And I'm just going to read it to you. And we'll just have story time here, and you just guys enjoy the story, all right? Last thing. During this time of great excitement, my mind was called up to serious reflection and great uneasiness. But though my feelings were deep and often poignant, still I kept myself aloof from all these parties. He's talking about the different churches at the time in upstate New York. There was a big religious revival going on. He's I'm coming into the part of the story here where he's talking about he's reflecting upon this religious excitement. Go ahead.
What year was it written on, approximately?
This would have been in around 1820. Yeah.
Early on.
1820. Where was I? I kept myself aloof from all these parties, meaning the churches, though I attended their several meetings as often as occasion would permit. In process of time, my mind became somewhat partial to the Methodist sect, and I felt some desire to be united with them. But so great were the confusions and strife among the different denominations that it was impossible for a person, young as I was, age 14, and so unacquainted with men and things, to come to certain conclusion who was right and who was wrong. My mind at times was greatly excited. The cry and tumult were so great and incessant. The Presbyterians were most decided against the Baptists and Methodists, and used all the powers of both reason and sophistry to prove their errors, or at least to make the people think they were in error. On the other hand, the Baptists and Methodists, in their turn, were equally zealous in endeavoring to establish their own tenets and disprove all others. In the midst of the war of words and tumult of opinions, I often said to myself, what is to be done? Who of all these parties is right, or are they all wrong together? If any one of them be right, which is it, and how shall I know it? While I was laboring under the extreme difficulties caused by the contest of these parties of religionists, I was one day reading the Epistle of James, 1st chapter and 5th verse, which reads, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and abradeth not, and it shall be given to him. Never did any passage of Scripture come with more power to my heart of man than this did at this time to mine. It seemed to enter with great force into every feeling of my heart. I reflected on it again and again, knowing that if any person needed wisdom from God, I did. For how to act, I did not know. And unless I could get more wisdom than I then had, I would never know. For the teachers of religion of the different sects understood the same passages of Scripture so differently as to destroy all confidence in settling the question by an appeal to the Bible. At length I came to the conclusion that I must either remain in darkness and confusion, or else I must do as James directs, that is, ask of God. I at length came to the determination to ask God, concluding that if he gave wisdom to them that lack wisdom, and would give liberally and not abrade, I might venture. So in accordance with this, my determination to ask God, I retired to the woods to make the attempt. This is a picture that you're seeing up here. It was on the morning of a beautiful clear day, early in the spring of 1820. It was the first time in my life that I had made such an attempt. For amidst all my anxieties, I had never as yet made the attempt to pray vocally. After I had retired to the place where I had previously designed to go, having not looked around me and finding myself alone, I kneeled down and began to offer up the desires of my heart to God. I had scarcely done so when immediately I was seized upon by some power which entirely overcame me and had such astonishing influence over me as to bind my tongue so that I could not speak. Thick darkness gathered around me, and it seemed to me for a time as if I were doomed to sudden destruction. But exerting all my powers to call upon God to deliver me out of the power of this enemy which had seized upon me, and at the very moment when I was ready to sink into despair and abandon myself to destruction, not to an imaginary ruin, but to a power of some actual being from the unseen world, who had such marvelous power as I had never before felt in any being, just as that moment of great alarm, I saw a pillar of light exactly over my head, above the brightness of the sun, which descended gradually until it fell upon me. It no sooner appeared that I found myself delivered from the enemy which held me bound. When the light rested upon me, I saw two personages whose brightness and glory defy all description, standing above me in the air. One of them spake to me, calling me by name, and said, pointing to the other, "This is my beloved Son, hear him."
Oh boy.
My object in to inquiring of the Lord was to know which of all the sects was right, that I might know which to join. No sooner, therefore, did I get possession of myself so as to be able to speak, than I asked the personages who stood above me in the light which all of the sects was right, for at this time it had never entered into my heart that all were wrong, and which I should join. I was answered that I must join none of them, for they were all wrong. And the personage who addressed me said that all their creeds were an abomination in his sight, that those professors were all corrupt, that they draw near to me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They teach for the doctrines and the commandments of men, having a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. He again forbade me to join with any of them. And many other things did he say unto me, which I cannot write at this time. When I came to myself again, I found myself lying on my back, looking up into heaven. When the light had departed, I had no strength, but soon recovering in some degree, I went home. So that's Joseph's story.
Question.
Sure.
When it was a reflective later that he write this, or this was a journal?
He's writing this version, and we're going to get to that. He's writing this one in 1838.
So
it would have been 18 years.
So he went back and reflected later.
Uh-huh. Yeah. But there's some problems with that, and we're going to talk about that. Okay. Cool story, huh?
Yeah.
Enjoy it?
Emphasis on the story part?
Story. We're going to get to that. So what doctrines do Mormons take from this first vision? And this is, two things. One, that God the Father and Jesus Christ are two distinct and separate personages, and that both have tangible bodies, as we've been talking about. And when you get into talking about the Trinity with a Mormon, and they'll give you some verses, where God's voice is coming from heaven, Jesus is being baptized, the Holy Spirit is coming in the form of a dove there, and they'll tell you that there's three different individuals there. And then when you give them, 10 more verses where the Bible's talking about they're all one, that there is only one God, and so forth, they'll always come back to this, yes, but we have an eyewitness. Oh. He has seen, and so that's where it always goes back to, is Joseph's story.
I've never troubled with the verse that says nobody has seen God the Father.
We're going to get to that in just a minute. We're going to get to those. The other thing that they get from this is that all the other churches are false, and that Jesus does not approve any of them. All right. So what they don't tell you, the truth, there are at least 9 different documented accounts of the first vision. We're going to go through those. 4 of which were given by Joseph Smith himself. 5 are second-hand accounts. Now, these accounts can be trusted as these men were leaders in the LDS Church and therefore disciples of Joseph Smith. Example, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wrote down the things they heard Jesus say. Therefore, they are also second-hand accounts. You understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus did not write Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wrote what they saw Jesus do, what they heard Jesus say. So these men wrote down what they heard Joseph Smith say. So when they pass them off to try and say, well, those are secondhand accounts. Well, the scriptures are all secondhand accounts for the most part, right? Most Mormons have only read the canonized story found in in their scriptures. So this story that I just read comes right out of their own scriptures. And this is the only one I ever heard for 20 years. Right? If you ask a Mormon, why are there so many different accounts of the first vision, they will tell you that they only know of one account, or they will repeat the answer that the church has taught them to say, which is this. The accounts only differ in emphasis. As Joseph spoke to different people in various circumstances, he would emphasize various aspects and details as to the to best fit the needs of the listener. This is not true. We're going to go through them. So this is sort of like, and they'll say, well, have you ever, you know, something, a story that's happened in your life, have you ever told the story multiple times to different people? And because of the audience you're speaking to, maybe you tell it a little different, you emphasize one thing over another. Well, actually, no, I haven't. If I have a story in my life, I tell it pretty much the same way every time. But that's what they get into. But we're going to see that that's not the case. And we're not going to read through every single version. Now you can, if you want to, you can go to Google the Mormon essays and go to the first vision accounts, and you'll see a lot of links coming off of that. And you can actually go and read each account. I've read them all. And so I've read them all, and what I'm going to do is show you what each one of them says, the highlights, the differences, okay, so to speak. So in 1832, Joseph Smith's first handwritten account. So this is 1832. The one we just read was 1838. So this is his first crack at it. He sits down to write this story, and this is what he writes. This is the differences, okay? So he says, by searching the scriptures, Joseph had already decided that the true church had fell into apostasy, and he was going to pray for instruction based on this knowledge. That's important. And this, in his first stab at this story, he said, yeah, I already know all the other churches are wrong. I figured that on my own. Now I'm going to God to figure out what to do about it. In his first account, he mentions nothing about Satan, darkness, all, you know, the dark power that bound his tongue, none of that's mentioned. I would think that would be something that I would want to include, right? It seems when we read that was a pretty important, detailed thing, right? Pretty important. In this one, he doesn't see necessarily light. He sees a pillar of fire that was like light that came down from above. He only saw Jesus. He only saw one person. That's important, because when we go study the Book of Mormon next week, we're going to find out in the original Book of Mormon, it teaches the Trinity. It teaches that Jesus was God. But when he changes his story here to two people, he goes back to the Book of Mormon and changes it to Jesus is the Son of God and separates them. Okay? Jesus says, all those who believe in my name shall have eternal life. This is grace.
Sounds good.
Sounds great, right? We believe this, right? So here you're going to see he's developing his story. So that's John 3:16 right there. Anybody that believes in Jesus, now you don't have to be a part of any church. You don't have to go to the temple. You don't have to do all these things. This is what his first stab at it was. Jesus says he is angry with the whole world because of their sins, and he is coming quickly. And then there's no mention of any other churches. So all of this, the apostasy and all this stuff, was not mentioned.
The 1820 version, how was that recorded then?
He says that this happened to him in 1820. That's the only part of his story that remains.
No, I realize in this, but the 1820, the one that you read to us, how was that made available?
No. The one I read to you was written in 1838.
Oh, I see. Okay.
This is, what I'm reading to you is the one that's all polished and shiny and the stories all come together.
Oh, okay.
When you go back to 1832, he hasn't gotten that far yet, right?
Okay. So it happened in 1820.
20. And he was 14 years old.
But recorded in
1838, which is the one that the church goes by. Okay? His first stab at it was 1832. And they don't tell you about all these other accounts, okay? They only tell you about the 1838 version. 1835, Joseph Smith, he takes another stab at it. And this one, he says, I knew not what was right and who was wrong. Now he's changed his story. Now he doesn't know which church is true. That was the reason he went to pray. This time his tongue seems swollen. He hears someone walking behind him. Then he specifies he saw a pillar of fire, not a light, a pillar of fire. One person appears, and then another one appears moments later. Then he sees a band of angels behind them.
But that's not in...
But there's no instruction.
That's not in the 38 verse.
No. They're all different. They're all different. And there's no instruction. There's nothing mentioned about churches, which one to join, which one not to join. No instruction. 1838, that's the one we just read, okay? He's getting a little more polished here. His purpose for praying was to know which church was true, for at that time it never entered his heart that all were wrong. Remember the first version, he said he'd already figured out they were all wrong.
Mm-hmm.
He's changing his story. Joseph was seized upon by a power that bound his tongue. The darkness gathers around him with marvelous power. Then he sees a pillar of light. Now it's not fire anymore. Now we're back to light. Then he sees two personages at the same time. Instructed him to join none of the churches, that all churches were wrong. Their creeds are an abomination. Their professors are corrupt. That means Pastor Larry would be corrupt, would be a corrupt teacher. Right? They teach the doctrines of men and deny God's power. And then he forbade Joseph to join any other church. All right.
I assume then he said originally that he had joined the Methodist Church, but he no longer was a member of the Methodist Church.
I don't think he ever joined any of them. He said that he was leaning towards joining the Methodist mm-hmm. Church. His mother was Presbyterian.
He attempted to join the church. He had someone who would allow him to join a sponsor.
Uh-huh.
He had a sponsor who sponsored him to join the church, but the church wouldn't allow him to join because of the
stories.
Stories. Yeah.
His stories of seeing God.
Can I add something else?
Sure.
So from 1820 till 1835, no one knew about the first vision. His mother, father, brother, sister, no Mormons, anti-Mormons, or Mormon historians. No one has any record of this for 15 years.
Right, yeah. So, and what was the first one? It was 1832, so it's 12 years after that is even trying to start to write the story down. All right, so in 1840, Orson Pratt tells this story. Again, this is what they call a secondhand witness, but this is what Joseph told him. He's writing it down. Joseph's great question was, which denomination be the Church of Christ? The question would not let him rest contented. He knelt down to pray, and at first he was severely tempted by the powers of darkness. Darkness gave away from his mind, and he was able to continue praying. That's different. He was tempted. He wasn't seized upon. He was tempted. A bright light descended from heaven. The entire wilderness was illuminated. His mind was caught away. This is different. Now, and we're going to see this in some of the other accounts, now it's not something that's physically happening to him. Now it's a vision. That's going to come into play next week when we talk about the Book of Mormon and the stories that they saw the angel, they saw the gold plates, later they recanted. So, well, it was a vision.
Oh.
So now it's a vision. He was enwrapped in a heavenly vision. Was that, somebody say something?
I just said he was tempted like Christ was. It's identifying the story again.
He wasn't seized upon, but he was somehow tempted into not doing what he was getting ready to do.
So is this
Orson Pratt
writing this?
Yes.
About Joseph?
Correct. He's retelling the story Joseph told him. Sort of like Matthew is retelling the story that Jesus, that he saw Jesus or heard Jesus say. Two glorious personages who exactly resemble each other. His sins are forgiven. That's more information. Informed that all denominations were believing in correct doctrines. None are acknowledged of God as his church. Commanded not to go after them. Promised that the fullness of the gospel would be made known to Joseph at a future time. 1842, Joseph Smith takes another stab at it. Joseph considers that all churches cannot be right, and that God could not be the author of such confusion, states. If God had a church, it would not be split into fractions. This is something you'll hear from Mormons a lot. God could not be the author of such confusion. Could God be the author of all this confusion? And as we go through these classes, there's a lot of confusion. There's a lot of recanting of stories. And how could God be the author? And polygamy, oh boy. That is not going to be... I'm putting that together. That is not going to be a rated G class. I'm sorry. Yeah. And how could God be the author of all that mess? No way. God would not tell one society to worship one way and then give another principles which were dramatically opposed. And this is the story in the Mormon Church. They think that we are, you know, at war with the Pentecostals and the Methodists and the Presbyterians, and that, you know, we wear gang colors and we go to each other's neighborhood and meet each other. I mean, they really, that's the story, that we're just always bickering with one another, and that you all know that that is not true. It is not the case. While praying, his mind was taken away and he was enwrapped in a heavenly vision. No mention of Satan.
Yeah.
Two glorious personages exactly resembled each other, surrounded by brilliant light. All religious denominations were believing in correct doctrine, starting to come together a little more. But Joseph's changed his story. Now his mind was taken away. He's pulling back a little bit here. Commanded not to go after them, promised that the fullness of the gospel would be made known to Joseph in future time. Levi Richards, 1843. Joseph taught about which of all sects were right. Prayed and asked the Lord which sects were right. No mention of Satan. Answer, none are right. All are wrong. The everlasting covenant was broken. Joseph, here's this another key. He says, Joseph understood the fullness of the gospel from the beginning to end and could teach it. So from that moment when he saw, had this vision, that he knew everything about the gospel and he could teach it from that point at 14 years old. Just another detail that Levi Richards brings into it, that obviously Joseph Smith had told him this, right? He wouldn't be writing it down. David Nye White. Joseph was serious about which church he should join. He prayed, O Lord, what church shall I join? No mention of Satan. He saw light, a glorious personage, then another person. Don't join any of them. They're all corrupt. Then he woke up on his back. So again, now he's having a dream. Alexander Neubauer. Joseph wanted to get religion like his mother, sisters, and brothers. He tried, but he could feel nothing. Mm-hmm. Went to pray. His tongue could not speak. Felt easier to speak after a while. Saw a fire toward heaven. Now we're back to the fire. Fire came nearer and nearer. Saw a personage in the fire. Light complexion. Blue eyes. Now he's able to see he's got blue eyes. Mm-hmm. White cloth over his shoulders. After a while, a second person came to the side of the first. Joseph asked, must I join the Methodist Church? Now he's asking a specific question. Answer, no, they are not my people. All have gone astray. There is none that doth good, no, not one. So obviously the men who are giving a recount of these first vision stories are doing so from different points in the evolution of Joseph's changing story, which means wherever Joseph was in his evolution, these men heard the story at that time. They're recanting it years later.
I'm sure he probably told his story, his visions, multiple times, and these guys could have been at different times. It was their interpretation of what he was saying.
Exactly. At different times, as he was evolving the story, they heard it at different times.
Were these men involved in the church?
Yes, they were all leaders in the church. Some of them were his apostles. Has anyone ever seen God? So now we're going to get to your question. face to face. So in Genesis.
And lived.
Genesis. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." They'll use this scripture. Hang with me. Exodus. The Lord would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend. Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me alive and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen." Sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? Stay with me. Deuteronomy. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Okay. John explains it. No one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Do you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing the work." So who did Jacob and Moses see? Daniel explains. And this is where Nebuchadnezzar, you remember, he has the three of them thrown into the fire because they wouldn't bow down and worship the idol. And what does Nebuchadnezzar say? He said, "Look, I see four men walking around the fire, abound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like the Son of God, the Son of the gods." So between what John is saying and what Daniel is saying, no one has ever seen that part of the Trinity called God the Father and live, but Joseph is the only man in history who claims to have done so. So what these scriptures are saying to you, and you can study this more in the Bible, is when, for instance, Jacob said he saw God face to face, and what Nebuchadnezzar is seeing here is the pre-incarnate Christ, that part of the Trinity that we are able to see, and man is able to have a relationship with, is Jesus Christ. But no one, and that's what John was saying, no one has ever seen that part of the Trinity called God the Father. Have I lost anybody? Mm-hmm. Everybody understand that? Mm-hmm. Probably already knew that. Sure. So what these scriptures are saying is that no one has ever seen that part of the Trinity that is called God the Father. Okay? All right? And Moses was talking to him, and he said, "You can't see my face." But in those places in the scriptures where it says that they saw the Lord face to face, they were talking about, John says, the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ. Nebuchadnezzar, he says that what he saw in the fire was someone who looked like the Son of the gods. They were seeing the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. But no one has seen that part of the Trinity face to face that we call God the Father, except Joseph, and lived. You're asking about the Book of Mormon, changes made to the Book of Mormon regarding the Trinity. So in 1830, the original copy of the Book of Mormon, it says this, 1 Nephi 11:18, "And he said unto me, Behold, the virgin whom thou seest is the mother of God after the manner of the flesh. After the first vision story changes, the current Book of Mormon says, "And he said unto me, Behold, the virgin whom thou seest is the mother of the Son of God after the manner of the flesh." See, that's doctrinal change. That's not a grammatical change, mm-hmm. right? That's doctrine. Again, back to the 1830, 1 Nephi 11:21. "And the angel said unto me, Behold, the Lamb of God, yea, even the Eternal Father." The current Book of Mormon, same verse. "And the angel said unto me, Behold, the Lamb of God, yea, even the Son of the Eternal Father." So as Joseph's story evolved over time, he had to go back and make some changes to the Book of Mormon. Again, 1830 version, 1 Nephi 13:40, "The Lamb of God is the Eternal Father." Current version, "The Lamb of God is the Son of the Eternal Father." Changes it.
By current, when is current?
Current is the one they carry around today.
At the same time. Mm-hmm. He wrote it, then he went back and changed it.
He went back and changed it. Yeah, but he changed it, but it's this is the way it looks today. The point is, when it was first printed, and he was still developing his story, he believed in the Trinity.
Well, that's
he was teaching the Trinity.
Determined. He eventually came in and he was the Father. And how much later did he make these changes? It says current.
Current. And actually, they've made several changes over the past 150 years.
Present day.
But okay. He would have changed it a few years later.
Okay. Second edition,
yeah. And there's been several editions. Back here first.
So in current, this is the King James Version?
No, this is the Book of Mormon. This is not the Bible.
So both of these are the Book of Mormon?
That's correct.
Oh, okay.
One is the 1830 version, which was the first print, right? So let me show you.
Sure.
This is the first print, 1830, right? And then this is what they carry around today. There's changes. It's not the same.
How easy is this to find an 1830 version?
Well, they're very expensive. I think they're like $30,000 if you can find one. This is a replica.
They've been sold for $1 million.
Okay. George says he's seen some for $1 million.
Okay, so how do you obtain a replica?
You can get one from the church bookstore, Deseret.
So they're still selling it, even though it has these gaping.
But you have to look for it. And most Mormons, they're not going to look for it. They're going to take it, just like I've had that for years.
So we really didn't know.
I bought it because it looked like the first. Oh, that's a cool novelty. Stuck it on the bookshelf. Never read it.
So we don't really know if Joseph ever himself changed this. But it changed
Joseph
it.
Changed it. He made the church admits that he was the one that made the
change. But not Joseph.
Joseph made those changes.
But we don't know when.
The second edition, I don't know when was the second edition.
It was roughly 2 years, what you said.
Yeah, 2 or 3 years later down the road. But since Joseph, and we'll talk about this again next week, since Joseph died, the church has made changes as it's continued to evolve its story. For instance, before 1978, the blacks were not allowed to have the priesthood.
Right.
And there were some things in the Book of Mormon about the Nephites being a pure and white, delightsome people. And then after 1978, when they allowed the blacks to have the priesthood, they had to go back and take that word white out and put pure. I think they use pure now. Well, how do you change the word of God? Right?
White out.
So, okay. In your younger years as a Mormon, did you have people pointing out these differences?
Not really. There were some people that, but you're taught early on, if somebody comes and tries to put down the Book of Mormon or put down Joseph Smith, they're anti-Mormon, right? That tells you that they're somehow evil, right? And they teach you to just, push these people away from you, run from these people. They're trying to, they're trying to take your testimony away.
I just wonder how Mormon today would respond to these differences being pointed out to them.
The other thing is, when I joined the church, there was no internet. there was no place to go and view these things and find these things and get answers and questions. Today's a different ballgame. Yeah.
So with the change of the ballgame with the internet, is there more questions or is there more doubt in the Mormon Church?
So the church has had, they've been forced to put out these, what they call the Mormon essays, where basically they're going back and admitting to their previous lies is what they're really doing. But they're not really promoting the essay so much. And what I think part of the reason they're doing that is that people like me, we were told a story, for instance, I'll just use polygamy. I was told by the Mormon missionaries that Joseph Smith never had more than one wife. It was Emma Smith, that was it. Yeah, it was polygamy was practiced a little bit for a few years in Utah. It's no big deal. And I joined the church and gave them my money, right? And so now all of this stuff is coming out because there's honest people in the church that have found these documents and so forth, and they've come forth and they're talking about it, and you got the internet and people sharing information. They've got to come clean. I think they're worried about being sued because it's theft by deception. You come and you teach me something that, a story that's not true, I believe it, give you my money based on the information you gave me, that's theft by deception, isn't it?
I had a couple of guys today that came by. We'd had an appointment. They were going to come by, have to work on my truck. And I tried to get them to watch the video with me that you have. I told them there's some stuff here. It's pretty good. You know, I don't really understand. Maybe you watch it with me and explain it to me.
Boy, would you like to plague, I bet.
We're not allowed to watch videos.
That's right. We're not allowed to watch the missionaries. You're talking about the missionaries, the elders.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're not allowed to view anything that is not church approved.
Right. So, but anyway, I still got a phone number.
Good.
How you come out of there and you know all this, how easy it is for you to get to tell them something that they will actually listen to you? How many people have actually...
They won't come and visit me anymore.
Okay, so they won't listen to you.
They've been told. Yeah,
well, I think an important note is what you had said last week, the average time for someone to come out, you said, was 7 years.
Okay.
Of hearing bits of truth and processing it, Because it's... like, it's going against everything that their life is based on.
Correct.
I mean, that would be a very earth-shaking...
It was for me.
They're in deep, their whole families are... Oh, how are you going to go home and tell your family? Guess what?
Yeah. Yeah, especially when your wife and all your kids...
Yeah.
And now, you know what I found out? I was lied to.
Well, when you're telling people the truth, you know you're tearing their guts out. I came out of a church. I had to leave a church because it just didn't wait for Bible. When I talk to those people, it hurts to talk to those because I know the pain they're going through, and that's below it.
Yeah.
It's rare.
You said they're changing, though. Are they changing for the good? Do you find that there's hope that they
may? Well, they can't run from the lies anymore because, like I said, there's been too many good, honest, decent people that have found this stuff and have exposed it, and because of the internet, they're sharing the information. They're having to come clean. I don't know how far it's going to go.
They believe they're Christians, right?
They believe they are, yes.
I can't remember the movie in the DVD we watched. And he was shown everything that was wrong. He was shown the truth.
And he still did.
And he could not. And he admitted that it was bothersome.
Oh, yeah.
But he hasn't come out.
Right.
Yeah, that was good, by the way. Everyone didn't see that.
Oh, that's awesome.
Watch.
That is really
awesome.
Yeah,
that was really good.
Yes, it is.
And still, and I have met those people, still, they see it, and you see the wheels turning, and you know it clicks.
He agreed with it, but he would not leave.
But I can't give up everything I love.
Exactly. And it's tormenting.
It's emotional.
But I felt for him because I could see the torment that's going through him, like you went through, like others who have come out.
But... When like I said last week, when an honest man finds that he's been mistaken,
yeah,
he either ceases to be mistaken or ceases to be
exactly
honest.
Exactly.
He's not going, how can he live with the rest of his life?
I know.
Not even being honest with himself.
On a lie. Living on a lie.
Back to your person.
Someone over here talked about change. I mean, for them to change, it's so ingrained that they have to start from scratch.
For the church to become a Christian denomination,
it almost seems like, yeah,
the leadership would have to come out and say, look, all this was a lie.
Yeah.
The Book of Mormon is a fraud. But you know what? If they would do that, I really believe it, there would be a lot of people that would leave. I really believe if they would just come clean, a lot of people like this guy would say, well, this is my people. I'm staying here and we're going to go through this together.
Yeah.
And we're going to turn to God. They could do that. They could do that.
Is this church still growing or is it losing members?
What I've heard is about 80,000 are a year are leaving because of the information that's getting circulated. And membership is declining. What I am hearing is that membership in Africa is rising because they don't have access to the internet and to figure things out, which is pathetic because those people are so poor and they'll join the church and give 10% of whatever they got.
Yeah.
You have to read it first. And with me, it touched me. There was a missionary, his mom wrote a book, the Wilder family, and I think his name's Micah. He's now in a Christian contemporary band called Adam's Road. But he was, I believe he was serving his mission in Florida, somewhere in the South, and he had spoken with a minister, and the minister told him, look, I know you're on your mission, you got certain things you can't do right now, but when you go home, just take the Bible and read it as a child. Forget all the other stuff and just read the Bible. Don't look at the footnotes, just read it. Like you're reading it for the first time and just listen to it. And his whole family came out of Mormonism. It's the Bible is the key.
Two things. One, I think that we forget that exempting people with facts and documents doesn't change their heart. That when you have it, still all of the Holy Spirit wants to reach out and touch them. Like you did here, and we give them the tools and see what we can't lay it out there and expect that that's going to be sufficient because we can't change their heart.
That's right. I've said before, you can beat Joseph Smith up all day long. That's not going to bring a Mormon to Christ. Mm-hmm. Only Christ.
Are they open to Bible study, though? I mean, if
they are.
They are open to Bible study.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
One other thing, could you repeat that quote you said about when an honest man is faced?
When an honest man finds that he's been mistaken, he either ceases to be mistaken or he ceases to be honest.
Yeah.
Who said that first? I don't know.
Cody Moore.
When an honest man finds that he's been mistaken, he either ceases to be mistaken or he ceases to be honest.
That is a great quote.
Parker 2017.
Yeah, I wasn't the first to say it. I don't know who was the first to say that. I can't find it. What else we got here? All right. The first vision count that the LDS Church stands behind today is, again, the 1838, teaches that the Godhead are three distinct individuals and three distinct gods, and separates itself from Christian doctrine of the Trinity. Mm-hmm. President Gordon B. Hinckley, which is the last prophet, 15th Mormon prophet, said this. And so when a Mormon says that they are Christian, that they believe in the same Jesus that you do, and that, do you believe in the same Jesus? Oh yes, we believe in the same Jesus. That's not what their prophet has said. He said, In bearing testimony of Jesus Christ, President Hinckley spoke of those outside the church who say Latter-day Saints do not believe in the traditional Christ. And he said, "No, I don't. The traditional Christ of whom they speak is not the Christ of whom I speak. For the Christ of whom I speak has been revealed in this, the dispensation of the fullness of times. He together with his father appeared to the boy Joseph in the year 1820, and when Joseph left the grove that day, he knew more about the nature of God than all the learned ministers of the gospel of the ages." 1998. And this is, I think I may have told the story, when my wife and I first went to discovery class here during that extremely emotional time. The very first class, the teacher asked us, he said, you know, who here, who's, you know, we were all in this class for the very first time. And so he asked, who's been a Christian, or I can't forget the wording he used, but who was already a Christian before this class, or have been a Christian for years or whatever. Everybody in that class raised their hand, and me and my wife looked at each other. We thought we were Christian, but this was the thought that came to my mind. If I've been following the Jesus Christ that appeared to Joseph Smith in the Sacred Grove in 1820, and that's not the Jesus that's in the Bible, and Gordon B. Hinckley said it's not, we couldn't raise our hand. We didn't know, we didn't discuss that right at that minute. We discussed it later when we got home. How come you didn't raise your hand? Well, how come you didn't raise your hand?
Dispensation of fullness of time.
So, okay, great question. So Mormonism teaches that there has been six dispensations of the gospel, and that the millennium will be the seventh. So the first dispensation would have been Adam, right? The gospel was given through Adam. I think the second one is Enoch, maybe. Then the third one would have been Noah. Then it would have been Abraham, Moses, Jesus himself, and then Joseph. And the seventh dispensation, I don't know how many I just named out there, but those are the major prophets, and with each major prophet was a dispensation. In other words, there was an apostasy every time. The gospel would be preached through the prophet over 1,000 years or so. The people would fall away, and God would have to dispense the gospel again. So it's a dispensation.
When you say something, you're talking and you lead them down a path, and then like, okay, this is enough right now, and you're going to back off, and then you go into something else. You say, well, what about, you know, and then they're very cunning, very, very cunning. It's shocking to me to see how they can even shut you off on that. You know what I mean?
I'll tell you how they're doing it. So before a missionary goes out on his mission, wherever he's going to go, he's going to go to Florida, he's going to go to Kentucky, he's going to go to Spain, wherever. First thing he does is, or she, goes to the MTC, Missionary Training Camp, or what the mission. Missionary Training Center in Salt Lake City, I think for 2 weeks, isn't it, George?
2 weeks if it's English speaking.
And maybe longer if they're doing
six
a foreign language.
6 to 7 weeks, depending on the language you have to learn.
Right. And so they get taught how to do this. And it's actually a business model. Business people, I forget the name of the model, but when they're trying to sell something, right, and they're trying to engage you, trying to be a salesperson. Now, one of the things that if the conversation is going in a contentious manner, or if it's going off somewhere where they don't want it to go, like polygamy, you bring the conversation back to a point of interest, something that you and I can agree on. We go back to that and forget about this place where you're wanting. They want to control the conversation and what you're talking about them being manipulative. That's what they're doing. They've been taught to do this. Mm-hmm. They want to control so that they give you the information they want you to have, but you're not going to get your information to them.
It's all a negotiation.
So you have to stay on them, and you have to realize what they're doing, and you have to keep the conversation going in the way you want it to go. And it may leave and never come back. But if you get that one seed planted in their head, that one bit of information that they just can't let that go when they get home off their mission, I can't forget that guy.
The rock
may
in the
save
shoe.
Their soul.
The rock in the shoe.
Back here than here. Yeah, that was a great analogy.
Okay.
I'm just kind of curious as to why they send out such young missionaries. I mean, in our method of sending missionaries, we take seasoned, educated adults to go out to be missionaries. The idea that they would entrust, you know, 19, 20, I don't know, they're pretty young, to go out and do the evangelism, if you will, or the
simple answer to that is a boy or young girl, boys are supposed to go on a mission. If a girl has a prospect for a husband, she doesn't have to go. Okay? But the boys are expected to go. That's a lot of pressure on a young man too, that I'm expected to leave my home for 2 years, leave my friends, put college off for 2 years after high school and go. And they may not even have a testimony of the church. Some of them will say they didn't, and then when they went on their mission, they gained one. But the reasoning behind that is a young man fresh out of high school, has no children, is not in college yet, is not married, has no responsibility. Whereas opposed to a 35-year-old man, has children, a wife, a job, and, you know, and some of them got 10 kids, you just can't just run off and not support your children. So that's why.
Does the church give them money to live on for those 2 years? Does the church support that?
No. To a degree, but the way it was when I joined the church, those missionaries, they started working after school during their teen years, and they saved up the money to pay for their own mission. And then their parents would also send money. They rent an apartment just like anyone else. They have to pay their rent, their meals. And then in recent years, they've even made them start paying a dollar for every Book of Mormon. Because I remember when I first joined the church, we'd take we'd pull up McDonald's and throw the book in there. But now that they're having to pay for it, they're a lot more particular on who they give it to. Right.
I noticed in what we've read so far, there's been no mention of the Holy Spirit.
Good point.
No, but we will talk about that when we talk about the Book of Mormon. Because
there was not any in his vision.
No. No. Because the Holy Spirit doesn't have a body. It's not something you can see.
In your comment up there, the first vision account, 1938, teaches that the Godhead are three distinct individuals, or can you elaborate on individuals? Do you mean individuals or do you mean persons? Because the Trinity creed that we believe in is that God is in three persons.
This is exactly what I'm talking about. Two separate people. God the Father and Jesus Christ. Two distinct gods.
Two distinct gods.
Gods. And the Holy Spirit is a third God that doesn't have a body yet. But after this whole thing plays out, and after judgment and all that, the Holy Spirit will receive a body as well, and will be a third person up there.
So they're all separate deities.
All separate deities, that's correct.
Thank you.
And there are billions upon billions of gods, and you too will be a god.
What do they say about the Old Testament, that the Jews were taught over and over again that the Lord our God is one? You know, how do they brush that off, or what do they say about that?
Well, that's what I'm saying. They'll bring up a few scriptures to try and separate them into distinct personages. people.
So they're talking about God the Father. They would say, oh, they were talking about the Father.
And then you'll bring up some
big God, right?
You'll bring up some scriptures that says there's only one God, that Jesus is one God. You'll go back to the verse we read in John. And then what they'll go back to is, well, but we have a prophet who saw with his own eyes that they are two separate individuals. They rely heavily upon the history of the church for their doctrine. And your Bible is corrupt.
Yeah.
But we have a prophet. See?
It just trumps.
You will never win that argument. You will, but not that way.
No. I talked to you a little bit about Revelations through them today. And what is their belief? Because they love, I said, you know, I found out that Jehovah Witnesses believe that a certain amount and the rest are going to be left behind. What is the Mormon belief on that?
That what is it now? That,
okay. 144,000.
Right, that's what I thought it was.
They never talk about that. Yeah, that's Jehovah's Witness. Yeah, I know what you're... What do they don't teach...
I mean, I see with Jehovah's Witnesses, and they love to talk about that.
I've asked that years ago when I first heard about that. Somebody, a Christian friend, had talked to me about that 144,000. And then I heard that that was a big Jehovah's Witness thing. I went and asked about that at church, and they said, you know, that's the stuff in the book of Revelations. We're never going to understand that. Don't concern yourself with it.
Well, what do they teach? Is what I'm asking. What is
they
that?
Don't.
They don't have any.
No teaching on the
144,000.
No teaching on the 144,000.
Do you mean like what happens after you die?
Yeah, in Revelations. I explained.
Oh.
So I go like, you know. So what? How do you agree with me on that? You know, what do you think? You know. And they're just like mumps of words. You know. They don't want to even talk about it.
The 144,000. They don't know anything about that. It's not discussed. It's not.
They have a different clarification. So Joseph Smith Sr. was the first patriarch of the church. He would bestow blessings upon the members. He charged a fee of roughly $2 at that time, which was roughly $15. So he actually got an income from doing this. In his patriarchal blessings to somewhere around 40 members that I'm aware of, I'm not saying all 40 had this, he did hundreds of them. He did mention the 144,000, that you'll be part of the 144,000. So if we go back to roughly 1836, it was talked about.
And that may very, very well be why it's not talked about today, because if you go digging that up, you'll figure out, well, that didn't come true. But it's just not talked about.
Do they believe in the rapture?
No. Not the way you believe in the rapture.
Well, that's what I was asking. What do they believe?
I think we are going to have a class where we talk about what they call the plan of salvation, where there's going to be a diagram up here, and we're going to walk you from the preexistence to your godhood, and we'll talk about that
next.
I'm sorry, say that again.
Ultimately, that's what they believe, that we'll all become a deity.
Correct. If you practice polygamy and...
Well, you got to have some
and get all the handshakes,
then you'll be a god. You have to have wives having spiritual babies so they can populate your planet.
Correct.
This was all before women's dead, you understand?
Okay, right here. You have a question.
What is he referring to when talking about the powers of darkness?
He's talking about Satan. He's talking about the powers of evil, or trying to. He's saying that the power of Satan was trying to keep him from praying, because Satan knew that once he got that prayer out, that the restoration would occur and the church, the apostasy would be over. And
they didn't say Satan.
He didn't say Satan, but that's the one more.
Can you share with us the Lectures of Faith number 5?
I don't have it with me right now. Do you remember it?
Yes, but
go ahead.
In the first book besides the Book of Mormon was called the Book of Commandments.
Right.
The Book of Commandments was published first in 1832. In 1835, it was changed to the Doctrine and Covenants, which is currently what the church uses today.
the doctrine was discussed in the first portion of the Doctrine and Covenants. The covenants are the teachings according to that doctrine. So you're describing the doctrine, and now I'm going to teach you the doctrine. You will also have revelations put in the Doctrine and Covenants. So I don't remember how many lectures, 10? Some around there? I think there were 10 lectures. And in lecture number 5, it says that God was a spirit, and that Jesus was a body of tabernacle. So he had flesh and bones, but God himself was a spirit. So we're talking about the first vision. We're seeing images, because these are the images I grew up with, that God himself is a man with bone and blood, Jesus bone and blood. But if you look at the first printings of the Book of Commandments and the Doctrine and Covenants, it refers to God as being a spirit.
Yeah, and we're going to have a class on the Doctrine and Covenants too, and he's right. This is called the Book of Commandments. And just like the Book of Mormon, it was printed, and then as the story evolved and the doctrines of the church were changed, they went back and reprinted it, and you can't find this anymore.
So, and that was 1832, you said?
I believe so.
1833, the Book of Commandments was written. And I'd like to add another thing, too.
Go ahead.
So, we're talking on the first vision here. In the 1833 Book of Commandments...
1835.
No, 1833 Book of Commandments would have been the first opportunity where Joseph could have put his vision in canon. But it's not put in Scripture in 1833. In church history, so that the members could have a true understanding of church history, and I believe that was also published in 1833. There's no mention of the first vision.
Right. Yeah. In a nutshell, this diagram here shows you what I'm talking about. Totally different stories, okay? First story is just Jesus Christ. Then there's a pillar of fire and an angel. Then there's a band of angels. And then the story evolves to where you get to the 1838 version.
These were supposedly all the same story. He just changed it along the
way. It evolved.
I have an uncle who did that.
It evolved. All right, let's move along here so we can finish up. Bible scriptures on a different Jesus. So again, we can go back to that last quote there from President Hinckley saying that no, in fact, the Bible that the Jesus that Christendom preaches about is not the same. So what does the Bible say about that? 2 Corinthians 11, but I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion of Christ. For if someone comes to you and preaches a Jesus other than the Jesus we preached, or if you receive a different spirit from the spirit you received, or a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it easily enough. What Paul's talking about here, there are people out there that are going to preach to you a different Jesus. And that's what all these cults do. A Jesus that has things added to or taken away from what Paul and the other apostles taught in the Bible. And it's interesting. He says if they preach another Jesus to you, and the Book of Mormon is what? Another Testament of Jesus Christ. That's the
name of it.
That's the name of it. You've lost information, important vital information.
Have you ever heard about the Dead Sea Scrolls? And mine is the wrong version.
That's right, but they don't talk about those things.
They won't address that at all.
No.
So when you would say that to somebody's on your doorstep, you know, that is.
What it'll be is new information for that person. Okay, that 18, 19-year-old boy, if you teach them about the Dead Sea Scrolls, that's going to be new information for them.
What did they say about the very end of Revelation 2? Nothing be added to or taken away from
them. Ah.
Yeah.
There's a scripture in Deuteronomy that says pretty much the same thing. And so what they'll say to you is, so Deuteronomy was written in blah, 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 B.C. Mm. So then everything after that would be an addition to the book of Deuteronomy. Oh, that's how they address that.
If you were going to step someone, a mom and dad, and try to have Bible study with them, where would you start? Where would you start in the Bible that you feel would engage them?
I would just start talking to them about the Bible, like we talked about last week, about why you can trust the Bible, because they believe that it has been corrupted. And you need to teach them how God preserved his word by making copies upon copies upon copies upon copies. And that if any changes were to be made, it would have stood out like a sore thumb in your tooth. You need to you need to get them to be able to trust the Bible so that they'll pick it up and read it.
And that's the first thing that they do is they take
they try to teach you not to read the Bible. And you need not to trust it, that it can't be trusted. So you need to reinforce to these young boys and girls why the story they've been told is not true. Okay, and that you can trust it.
Your video that you had us do for homework is compelling.
It's excellent.
It tells the whole story.
Yes. Read that or watch that video. Learn that information. Know that information. That'll get you started.
I thought the Mormon that was on that video was extremely brave to be a part of that.
He was. He was. I thought the same thing.
And then
for him to sit there and agree to be filmed was something too.
Yeah, and not get up and walk away. I mean, I almost cried at the end.
And I'm sure he probably got a lot of backlash from his friends too.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. It got a mark on him for even going near them and listening to them.
I'm sure.
Yeah, but that's John 8:32 in action. You shall know the truth, for you shall set you free.
Well, he learned the truth, but he still didn't buy it.
No.
Okay, one more scripture here. And I love this scripture because, you know, Joseph said that he was a prophet and he has the 12 apostles under him. So he's walking around like Jesus with his 12 apostles and they're coming up with all these different doctrines that aren't true. And I will keep on doing, this is what Paul says about that kind of thing. And I will keep on doing what I am doing in order to cut the ground from under those who want the opportunity to be considered equal with us in the things they boast about. For such people are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It is not surprising then, if his servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness. Their end will be what their actions deserve.
Amen.
Amen. Conclusion. Joseph Smith's story evolved over time, therefore it is a lie from his own imagination.
We're out of time.
And we're about out of time. Any last questions? One back there.
As someone who was Mormon and now involved in Christianity, do you believe Joseph Smith was in hell?
I do believe that.
I didn't know what it said.
He asked me if I believe Joseph Smith is in hell, and I said yes, I do.
In the pit of hell.
And as we go, we're only getting started on some of the things that he did. This, but you know, rewriting the Bible, putting himself in there. Claiming that, you know, all of his polygamy and polyandry, the claim that Jesus told him to do, you know, he blames everything on Jesus. And then the quotes about, you know, every time God, you know, God failed here and God failed there and Joseph had to fix it.
Yeah. It sounds similar to the relationship that Satan once had. He wanted to be like God and then he was thrown down.
Right.
I mean, very, very strong correlation to the exact same thing.
All
right, thank you.
All right. Well, again, next week we're going to talk about the Book of Mormon. It's going to be a lot we're going to have less questions, and it's going to be a lot of information, and I'll try to get us...
Hold all the questions till the end.
Maybe we can get through the information and have time to do questions, and then those that want to leave can leave. All right, so let's pray out.